Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to you and a particularly warm welcome to the University of Birmingham. It's great to see so many people here, students, faculty, visitors, friends from the community. Thank you very much indeed for coming this evening. My name is Andy Schofield. I'm a Pro Vice Chancellor here. I head the College of Engineering and Physical Sciences. I'm also a Professor of Theoretical Physics. This is the first so-called Veritas Forum, the origin of Veritas is that it was founded in 1992 at Harvard University by a group of students, faculty and university chaplains, and it is dedicated to placing historic Christian faith in dialogue with other beliefs and inviting participants from all backgrounds to pursue truth together. And that notion of pursuing truth, I think, is particularly important. Veritas is the Roman virtue of truthfulness. And given that the Oxford English Dictionary claimed that post-truth was the word of 2016, I think it is up to universities to put at the foreground the quest for truth. Since its foundation in 1992, Veritas has spread from Harvard to more than 200 universities in North America and Europe. And in the UK, events have been held at Oxford and Cambridge. And this is the first event outside Oxford and Cambridge to take place in a university in the UK. I guess having tested it at a few more modestly ranked institutions, it was time to try it here. Joke. In terms of the format for tonight's event, in a second I will introduce our speaker, Art Louis. Art will speak for, I think, roughly 40 minutes or so with some video clips to keep us all entertained, after which there will be an opportunity for questions. And I am told that a mobile phone number has been dedicated to receive those questions in the form of a text. And the significance of that is that in terms of bringing dialogue into this, it's quite helpful if questions can be succinct and to the point, and the exercise of turning them into a text may help us all do that. There will, of course, be opportunity to take questions from the floor. And we will run a question and answer session that Art has very kindly agreed to respond to. The event will finish before 9 o'clock, and those of you that need to go before that, of course, are welcome to do that. We'll aim to finish a bit before that because there are some refreshments served afterwards. And because for us this is an experimental event, there are feedback forms which hopefully you've picked up. And we very much value your feedback as to whether we should run such a thing again. And there are boxes at the door for you to fill those, to put your completed forms in. I think that covers the format of this evening's event. And now it remains for me to introduce Professor Art Louis. I guess the last time I saw you here, Art, was when you came to give a seminar to the theoretical physics group. That then hints at Art's discipline. Art is a theoretical physicist, currently working at the University of Oxford, where he's a professor. He works at the interface of chemistry, physics, and biology. He's also the director of graduate studies in theoretical physics there. Prior to moving to Oxford, from 2002 until 2010, he held a Royal Society University Research Fellowship, first in Cambridge and then, I guess, moved it to Oxford. He is also a member of a number of august institutions. He's an associate of the Faraday Institute for Science and Religion, on the board of directors for Biologus, which works towards an understanding of the harmony between sciences and biblical faith through an evolutionary understanding of God's creation. Perhaps we'll hear something about that. And in 2013, he was elected a member of the International Society for Science and Religion. He's been involved in Veritas for several years and has spoken at fora throughout North America and in the UK. He also has a strong media presence appearing in National Geographic's The Story of God with Morgan Freeman, and has made a series of videos with independent filmmakers. And we are delighted to have him here as our speaker tonight. So please will you join with me in welcoming Professor Art Louis.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Andy. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here to speak to all of you on these kinds of big questions. I think sometimes these kinds of big questions have been, or the kind of thing that motivate you to go to university in the first place. It's why you come, it's why you want to study, you want to think about what the big questions are. And then we professors do our best to beat it out of you while you're here. But hopefully sometimes events like this can help you think about these things. And today the title that I have is Meaning, Evidence, and Truth. Can science answer all our questions? And I've been very interested in this because over the last 2 years or so, I've made a documentary series with a friend of mine, David Malone, who's, David's quite a keen atheist. I'm a Christian and a scientist, and so we made a, he was an atheist and an artist. I'm a Christian and a scientist, so we thought we'd make a good duo. We went around the world talking to people about this, and this question of meaning. And so I want to just start with a little clip from our documentary series.
In every place.
So the title of our first episode is called Meaning-Seeking Beings, because I think we all are meaning-seeking beings. We seek meaning. We're trying to figure out why are we here? What's the meaning of life? What's the meaning of the things around us? Why are we here? And so those are really important questions, the kind of questions that you have to think about at university. And I've always been interested in big questions. I'll give you an idea of the kind of research I do just to introduce myself to you a little bit, to humanize myself or dehumanize myself, depending on your love of science. So this is myself, actually. I grew up in Gabon in Central Africa. How many of you know where Gabon is? Do you know? A few people do. So Central Africa, jungle. My parents are biologists, and so we lived in the jungle, and we had a pet chimpanzee growing up. His name was Bertje. And in case you can't see the difference, this is my chimpanzee, and that's me. My mother says we look different, at least I hope we look different, but we behave remarkably similarly. And it turns out that as I went on and started studying things, I realized that I share, 50% of my genes with flies, 70% with a frog, and if you kiss a frog, then it becomes a prince, you share even more of your genes. And I shared 98% of my genes with Bertje, my chimpanzee. And so one question that I started thinking about quite early as a child was, what makes me different? Why am I different from this chimpanzee? And it turns out that I share most of my genes, so what makes me different? And the reason why it seems surprising that I would be share 90% of my genes and 8% of my genes with a chimpanzee or 70% with a frog, I feel like I'm a little bit more than 2% different than a chimpanzee. Well, people differ on that question, but I think I am. And the reason is because we tend to think about genes as kind of blueprints, like architectural drawings, right? And so the more two drawings look like each other, the more that they must overlap. So I have a principle that I have always held to in these kinds of general talks that I'll try to teach you one little piece of science. So one piece of science is, you probably, if you're not a biologist, think about your genes as kind of blueprints, but that's the wrong way of thinking about them. If you think about genes, you can also think about them as interconnected switches. So a lot of the genes in your body are actually switches. They switch things on and off. And just like a transistor, right, has made lots of switches and can be rearranged in different ways to make all kinds, it could be an oscillator, or it could be, it could do all kinds of different things depending on how you switch the components. In the same way, our genes can be rearranged and switched in all kinds of very interesting ways. So a better metaphor, perhaps, for thinking about how your genes make you is something like a transistor. And so that's why I, as a physicist, am interested in this, because it turns out I can turn this little picture here, which is each of these little dots is a gene, each line is telling you that this one is switching that one, is switching that one. This one right here is switching a lot of people. It's very important. I can turn that all into a set of beautiful equations, and physicists like this kind of stuff. So I consider these to be very beautiful equations that I can spend my time on. Another kind of big question I worried about as a child really had to do with the kind of general thing when you look at the universe and you wonder how big it is. So when I look at the stars, what is it that makes us who we are. There are, we think, about 10 to the 22 to 10 to the 23 stars in the universe, more stars than we can ever imagine. There's a very famous saying in the Book of Psalms where the writer wrote, "When I look at the stars, what is man that you are mindful of him?" And that kind of sense of looking at nature and seeing the grandeur of it and sensing yourself to be very small is a universal sense. And the question is really, what does that mean? And you can in fact take that sense and expand it out to something even bigger and ask yourself not only what does it mean by me, or where did this stars come from? Where did this universe come from? And that's a kind of maybe the ultimate big question that we might have is, where did this universe come from? Why is it here? And I remember even as a relatively young child wondering about this and trying to get my head around it, not getting very far, and wondering, where does this universe come from? And so the ultimate big question we might have in our lives is really, why is there something? In other words, why is there something rather than nothing? I don't know if you've ever, some people are looking at me slightly puzzled, wondering why on earth are you worrying about that? But think about it, it's kind of strange. Look around yourself, everything you see, the beauty of nature, people around you, everything. Wonder why is this all here? Why is there something rather than nothing? It's the kind of ultimate deep question. And we might hope that by looking at this question, we'll get some sense of why we're here or where we're from. And what's interesting about this question, the reason I'm harping on it a little bit, is because I think it points towards a very important principle that I want to get across today, which is that as much as science helps us in sharpening and in formulating these questions, it doesn't really help us in answering them. And I want to illustrate that to you with this question. So why is something rather than nothing? Well, one possibility would be that something has always existed. And so when we think of why is our universe here, we really shouldn't think initially about why is the matter here that makes our universe. But we should ask ourselves the question, why are the laws of nature, the laws of physics, that allow our universe to exist? Where did they come from? Why are they here? So one possibility would be those laws have always existed. There have always been laws of nature. And or else maybe there are previous laws of nature that cause our current laws of nature. Either way, you have something that is very odd, because something, the question is, what caused those laws that caused our laws? Well, some other set of laws that caused those laws. And it goes on ad infinitum. And so you have something which is definitely different from anything that we know in science, something which has an infinite series of causes, or something which might have actually been itself, has always been. So that's a possible but a difficult thing to get your head around. The other possibility would be, well, okay, if you don't like that, you don't like this idea of an infinite regress, then perhaps the laws of nature just popped into being out of nothingness, out of ontological nothingness, right? So that means, nothingness means not just empty space that something pops into, but real nothingness. So no laws of nature, no laws of mathematics, no laws of logic, real nothingness. So again, that's possibility, but it's a very strange one. And if you're a naturalist, if you believe that there's nothing except the laws of nature and what they've caused, then you're more or less stuck with one of these two options. Either the laws of nature have all existed, or they're preceded by some other set of laws of nature ad infinitum, or they popped into being out of real, true nothingness. Now, either of those could be true, right? It's hard to know which one is true, but they are definitely metaphysical, philosophical points. So those, and they're both rather unsatisfying, I think, but some people find them very satisfying. The other option would be that the whole of space-time is dependent on a non-spatio-temporal reality, a being who cannot not exist. So that sounds very complicated. So let me explain to you in a slightly simpler way. So this would be what theists would traditionally call God, right? So when theists, like Christians or other major religions, think about God, they don't think about God as a being like ourselves, who's only bigger bigger and smarter. But God is somehow something completely different. So God would be the final cause, in the words of the early theologians, or the first cause. The reason why, the way that you get around this problem of having either something exist eternally or something popping out of true nothingness would be There is something that's not part of this natural world, which is who has a different kind of nature and therefore caused this world. Now, if you're not a theist, then that's going to sound a little bit odd because I'm introducing some concept of God to you. And I'm perfectly happy for you to find that odd. I just wanted to point out that all three of these options are odd. So all of us are kind of stuck in this world, whether you believe in God or not believe in God, in having some kind of premise which on its, just by itself, looking at it just by itself, seems odd. And it's definitely not scientific, it's philosophical or theological. So every single one of you in this room is a philosopher or a theologian of some kind. You have some kind of philosophy or some kind of theology. And I just wanted to point that out at the beginning. That was a bit of a heavy way of starting. But I wanted to start that way because I want to get you away from the idea that these questions about science and faith and how they interlink are really about science. They're really a lot more about philosophy or theology. So the question, of course, is why have you invited a theoretical physicist to come speak to you on these topics? And that's, I'll leave that up to the organizers. I mean, obviously, as a scientist, I've thought a lot about this and thought about these questions, and I think they're really fun questions. And of course, what's probably motivating many of you is this kind of idea in the background that floats around in our society that science has been, you know, enormously successful. I think science is an unbelievably successful thing that humans have engaged in, perhaps the greatest achievement that humans have ever, the greatest thing that humans have ever achieved. And yet, and so it's easy to sense that if it's been so successful, won't it one day answer all of our questions? And so in this documentary that we made, this was one of the questions we really wanted to address. And so we interviewed a few people who did a much better job than I will of presenting their case. And so this is the Alex Rosenberg, a philosopher who I really enjoyed interacting with. So those are two of our people we interviewed. So Alex Rosenberg and Peter Atkins, very distinguished philosopher, very distinguished chemists. And really enjoyed interacting with them. They enjoyed interacting with us. They've seen the film. They really liked it. So I think we did a good job putting their points forward. It won't surprise you if I tell you I'm a Christian and a scientist that I don't agree with them. If we could have thrown them in here, we could have had a longer discussion perhaps together. But I think rather than quoting them, I'd ask this question: is this true that science will answer all questions? And there is a temptation to feel that way, because surely if you just look around our current world, look at the advances we've had in medicine, compare us to 100, even 100 years ago, the advances have been really dramatic. So that's an enormous advance. So if you think about this little computer that you hold in your pocket, right? It's an amazing technological advance. You always wonder to yourself, what would aliens say? And they come down to Earth and they say, these humans are amazing. They've created these computers that they can hold in their pocket. They're incredibly powerful machines that can do thousands of calculations in a millisecond. And they spend most of their time looking at cat videos. Okay, I'll leave that for a different question. So it's true it's natural to think that, you know, shouldn't this just extend into everything, right? Shouldn't we therefore get rid of this kind of old-fashioned superstitions of religious or other ways of knowing and try to use this very reliable way of knowing to get somewhere? But I want to quote another famous atheist, actually, from Oxford, Sir Peter Medawar, a Nobel Prize winner, who wrote on this topic, that there is indeed a limit upon science is made very likely by the existence of questions that science cannot answer and that no conceivable advance of science would empower it to answer. These are the questions that children ask. I have in mind such questions as, how did everything begin? What are we all here for? And what is the point of living? I remember asking myself those questions as a child. And it is not to science, therefore, but to metaphysics, imaginative literature, or religion that we must turn for answers to questions having to do with first and last things. And then he goes on and says, science is a great and glorious enterprise, the most successful, I argue, that human beings have ever engaged in. To reproach it for its inability to answer all the questions we should like to put to it is no more sensible than to reproach a railway locomotive for not flying, or in general not performing any other operation for it which was not designed. So what we what we see here is that there's a kind of difference of views even among those who don't have any kind of religious faith about whether science can answer these really ultimate questions. And so I wanted to just touch on that a little bit with a few slides. I'm just going to take a few side steps to the left and steps to the right, and hopefully in the Q&A we can really get to the heart of this matter. So the first thing is, I want to kind of get rid of a bit of a myth that sometimes floats around, which is that scientists are not Christians, or very few scientists are Christians, or the more that you get into science, the less you believe in God. So this coming weekend, actually, so tomorrow and Saturday, a bunch of faculty, friends of mine at the University of Oxford, we run a course for Christian students called Oxford Christian Minds for Christian graduate students to think about their subjects, and there's a philosophy stream and a theology stream and a history stream, and it's like a humanities stream, a social science stream, and a natural sciences stream, and they're all taught by Oxford academics who are Christian believers of some kind or the other. And it turns out that the science stream, which is the one I run, has by far... So for the other ones, we have to sometimes ask people. People are very busy, and get them to come. For the science stream, my main problem is I've got so many of my colleagues who would like to talk about this. I have to kind of manage them a little bit and invite them one this year and then one next one the next year, because there are many of us. And sometimes in my experiences when I'm outside of the academy particularly, people say to me, oh, you're a scientist and you're a believer, and they think it's very strange, as if I'm, you know, a vegetarian butcher, somebody who doesn't really believe in what they do, but I think that's not right. And one of my colleagues, Andrew Briggs, has written a really lovely book on science and faith, which he called The Penultimate Curiosity. And I really like this because I think it describes how I feel that science works. So the ultimate curiosity are the big questions, like why are we here and what is life about, and the kind of religious questions we are: is there a God, and if there's a God, what is that God like? And the penultimate questions are what he considers to be the scientific questions, the questions about how do things work and how are they all put together. And he says this often swims in the slipstream of the ultimate questions. Now, I really like that because it helps me, I think, understand a little bit about why science is so inspiring, why it's so fun, because it's slipping in the slipstream of these great questions. And we see that historically, that science has these deeply Christian roots. Here's a quote from Isaac Newton, who said, "This most beautiful system of the sun, moon, suns, planets, and comets can only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent being." Newton wrote more about theology than he wrote about science. Now, it turns out he wasn't a very good theologian, so we remember his science. But the fact is that he was deeply motivated by theological considerations. We see Robert Boyle, who was the founder of modern chemistry. You probably remember Boyle's Law from secondary school, who wrote a book called The Wisdom of God Manifested in the Works of Creation. It was, again, somebody who was actually mocked by his peers for his religious faith. And so we see that there's basically a deep history of interaction between science and faith through time. And one of the things that's come out of that is that theism actually, so believing in God, was both historically really important for the birth of science, in the sense that many of the people who started science up had deeply Christian beliefs, and these beliefs motivated them to do their science. But in fact, there were really important theological concepts that underlied being able to do science. So if I do science, I'm assuming a whole number of things. I'm assuming that the world is intelligible. That means that I can understand something about the world. I assume that the world is uniform. So uniformity basically means that if I do an experiment here in Birmingham, then under really well kind of conditions, somebody in, say, Cambridge should be able to get the same result, at least if they're smart. Right? And so maybe, I see. Perhaps that would be the case. So, and that's because, you know, we think nature is uniform. In other words, what I do here under well-contrived conditions should be the same as anywhere else on the globe. In fact, probably anywhere else in the universe. And we're so used to that idea that we don't question it. But it's not at all obvious. For most people, in most time, the nature doesn't seem to be that regular. It seems to be capricious. And so the question is, why did people start thinking perhaps the world is uniform, perhaps it can be studied in this very well-controllable way? Well, if you believe there's a God who created the world, and if you believe this is a God who's a good God and a God, and a faithful God, then it's not so surprising that the ways that God sustains the world might be regular. And that kind of idea is really important for the grounding of modern science. So that's the first of the kind of big questions that I want to look at, just how do science and faith link? I wanted to get rid of the idea that somehow, in practice, this is a a question of great conflicts for scientists who are believers. It tends not to be. And historically, it hasn't been. The second question I want to ask, I want to get to, is the question of who am I? This is a kind of big question. who am I? Well, that's kind of interesting. I can think about that in lots of different ways. So I am, in fact, a self-assembled biological machine, which is true. I am a self-assembled biological machine. In other words, one of the great things about your body, which is amazing, is that once you're born, right, you're no longer everything gets kind of made by itself. Even inside your mother's womb, it's not like there's a factory in there that's putting things in. Things just kind of naturally come together in the self-assembled way. It's really cool. In fact, in my laboratory, we work on self-assembly. Like, how do you make things that make themselves? So I am a self-assembled biological machine. I'm also the product of my genes. My genes have had a very important effect on who I am. I am also a member of a social system. So part of who I am is a member of a social system. I am gendered, which can be really important. I'm a citizen of the Netherlands, in fact. We voted yesterday. And I'm an economic actor. Sometimes people want to reduce me to nothing but an economic actor, but I like to think that I'm a lot more than just that. I'm also a father. And all these things are part of my identity. So when you ask me, who am I? Every single one of those things is true. And they're not, just because one of them is true doesn't mean the other ones are not true. In fact, I am a Homo sapiens. I'm from the kingdom Animalia, phylum Chordata, etc., all the way down to species Homo sapiens. So I am a Homo sapiens. And hopefully, as far as I can tell, most so are all of you. And I'm also a collection of chemicals. So I'm made of about 60% water. And in fact, I've got enough iron in myself for about 2,000 matches, enough phosphorus for 2,000 matches, enough iron for one nail, enough chlorine to disinfect a swimming pool, and enough soap, for about 10 bars of soap, or perhaps a few more. Probably a few more, actually. And so I am a bag of chemicals. Now, for those of you in the audience who are hoping for romantic relationships, let me give you some piece of advice. So assume that one day you, as a young man, are sitting at a table, and the lights are low, and it's a very nice restaurant, and you've got some very nice food, and you've got a flower on the table and some candles, and everything's going very well, and the object of your affections looks at you and says, maybe let's say your name is Bob. So Bob, how well do you know me? Do you really know what I'm made of? If you then say, those of you who have been in this kind of situation know that's a dangerous question. You have to get the right answer, or you'll be in big trouble. So you panic a little bit, and then you suddenly remember that you went to a lecture the night before, and somebody told you that you're made of chemicals. You say, darling, you're made of chemicals. Enough phosphorus for 2,000 matches, enough iron for one nail, enough chlorine to make a swimming pool, enough fat for 10 bars of soap, at which point you will get a slap, even if you say just one bar of soap. Yeah? And the reason is because somehow instinctively we sense that if I reduce you to the chemicals that you're made of, that I've somehow missed out on what you are. And hopefully that will be obvious for you if you ever come into that situation where you're asked, somebody asks you, who do you think that I am? And the reason for this is linked to this very famous example that goes back to Frank Rhodes from Cornell. And it's the following. Let's say you come into my home, and I've got a kettle of water boiling, and you ask me, why is water boiling? And I say, there's a thermal heat source that transfers energy across the container wall into the fluid. That means that the mean square velocity of the molecules increases. The mean square velocity is proportional to the temperature. When the temperature reaches 100 degrees Celsius, there is a phase transition from a condensed phase to an expanded phase, which we call melting. Oh, sorry, you should call it boiling. It's going to fail you. I'll fail your thermodynamics test, Andrew. So that's a good answer. The other answer could be you come into my home and you see that the kettle is boiling and you ask me, why is the kettle boiling? And I say, well, I fancy a cup of tea. Would you like some? And if I give you one answer, or if I give you the other one, neither of these contradicts the other one. They're just two different ways of looking at something. So just because I've explained the mechanism for you by which something works, the mechanism by which something boils, doesn't mean that I've therefore denuded it of all volume. So though, even if I give you the scientific explanation for why something happens, whether that be a social phenomenon or a physical phenomenon, doesn't mean that I've therefore explained it away. So that's the question about who I am. Who am I? I'm all these different things. I'm a biological machine all the way up to a social actor. But I think I'm more than that. And one interesting way of thinking about that is to ask myself, how would I measure the value of a human life? So measuring the value of human life or considering whether a certain human being is valuable is a really important thing in our modern society. In our modern society, we by and large agree that humans' life is valuable, period. We believe in the kind of sanctity of human life. And that is something which traditionally has been based on deeply Christian presuppositions. But let's say you don't like those and you want to try to use science to explain this. So you'd like to use a scientific method to really explain what the value of a human being is. Wouldn't that be great? Then we wouldn't disagree about this anymore and we'd all have this one nice method of figuring this out. But let's say I try to use science to describe the value of a human being. How would I do that? Well, it's really hard. So if I was a chemist, I might look at the value of the elements that you're made of, but that seems pretty silly, right? Somebody with gold fillings is not worth more than somebody without gold fillings. Or if I was a physiologist, I might look at the size of your brain, or a psychologist, how smart you are, or an anthropologist, how the community values you, or an economist, how much economic value you produce. But we immediately sense that each of those different ways of trying to work out our value is deeply flawed and is actually almost offensive if I were to try to do that to you. And the reason for that is that we need some other source of some other source of value for the idea that we value human beings. And science simply can't give that to us. Now, I had a few clips that I wanted to show you on this, but I had a little AV problem, so I'll skip them. And I'll try to expand on this. So what I've tried to say to you is, if I use science to explain something about you, like the fact that you're made of chemicals, that doesn't mean I've explained away every other level of meaning. There may be other levels of meaning. And I've given you one really important level of meaning, which is a kind of moral level or a value level, right? How do I value human beings? And argued that science really can't give us any great guidance. It can sharpen the questions, but can't tell us how we should value human beings. And I've got a friend at Stanford, Bill Newsom, who hosted me actually for the Veritas Forum there a few years ago, a very famous neuroscientist. And once he was walking across the Stanford campus with one of his colleagues, and the colleague didn't like this chapel, which is a very famous chapel, if you ever go to Stanford, it's well worth seeing, called Memorial Chapel. And the colleague said, you know, we should just blow this thing up because it's a monument to irrationality. And Bill said, why? Well, you know, because there's people that are religious there. They believe in kind of things that can't be, they're not scientific things. And then Bill said, well, okay, if you want to hold to that, then perhaps you should blow up my house as well, because my house is also a monument to irrationality, if on your terms. And so obviously the colleague was wondering what was going on. So Bill kind of gave I might switch the voice to myself. So Bill gave the example of getting married. I'll give the same example for me. So a number of years ago, actually a little while ago, I got married. And if any of you in the audience would like to get married, you'll see that there are rational ways of choosing a spouse and irrational ways of choosing a spouse. So a truly rational way of choosing a spouse is to go onto the street and find the best girl that you see and say, please marry me. That's irrational. If the girl says yes, that's scary. because something isn't quite right. So what you do is you get to know the other person, right? So you get to know the other person and you see whether you enjoy being together. That's actually quite important. And you might ask your friends or people that you in your community that you trust, what do you think of the two of us together? You do other things, like for example, my wife and I did these kind of compatibility tests in our pre-marriaging, you know, where they you have to fill out this whole long series of questionnaires. I see a few married people shaking their remember this day. You fill out these long forms, like how do you hold, where do you squeeze the toothpaste, this kind of stuff. It's quite illuminating. But you don't marry somebody because you both score 95% on the compatibility test. There has to be something more to it. So So the point is, there are irrational ways of choosing a spouse, and there are better ways of choosing a spouse, or hopefully better ways of choosing a spouse. But in the end of the day, you can't really use a scientific method to choose a spouse. And one of the reasons for that is, in the scientific method, you do repeated experiments, and you shouldn't do repeated experiments in marriage if you can help it. The other thing about the scientific method is that you really want to know something pretty sure. But the point is, until you're married, you don't know what it's like to be married to the other person. So you take you're taking what's really a leap of faith. You gather some evidence together as well as you can, and then you take a leap of faith and say, well, I'm just going to see what it's like, because you don't know what it's like until you're married. So that knowledge is not accessible to you until you've made a step of faith. And I would argue that most really important knowledge has that kind of character to it. If I were to use the scientific method to try with my wife, I'd say to her, well, I'm not going to marry you until I'm scientifically sure that you're the one that I'm going to marry. And she would have probably left me for somebody better a long time ago. And because I'll never know for sure, because I'll never get that information. At the same time, if I also behave in the kind of scientific way, which is a good way of work doing science, which is being skeptical about something until I have evidence to the contrary. That's how science works. If I say to my wife, I'm skeptical that you love me unless you give me evidence that you love me, that's kind of a pathological way of interacting, if that's how you, by the way. The fact is, there's lots of evidence that I'll never see. Instead, I've got to take a step of faith and believe that she loves me and treat her in that way. And then there's a lot of evidence that I'll actually see of whether she really does or doesn't love me. So a lot of knowledge that's really important, relational knowledge, for example, has this kind of step of faith type aspect to it. And if you try to reduce it to the kind of spectator knowledge of science, then you're missing something really important. And unfortunately, what that means is that really a lot of the important things in life are not that accessible to the scientific method. Scientific method can help us a little bit, but only partially. It's a little bit like the following example. You're walking late at night somewhere in Birmingham in a very dark alley, and you see a man under a bright light. And he's looking for his keys. And so you ask him what's happened, and the man says, I've lost my keys. And so you help this man looking around for a while. And after a good while, you haven't found the keys, and you want to search the entire area, you ask him, sorry to bother you, sir, but are you sure you lost your keys here under the light? He says, well, I have no idea where I lost my keys. Okay, but under the light, I know that it's bright, so I can at least see here. Right? And that's why he's looking there. And if you think that science can answer all the questions, it's a little bit like this man, right? So you're on a street with lights very bright. Science is a very bright light that shines itself in your laboratory or in other scientific environments. And the reason it's so bright is because we limit science really to very specific kinds of questions. But all the kind of interesting questions, the important questions, the questions of life, of meaning, of personal knowledge, of relational knowledge, are just a little bit out there in the shadows, and they're a little bit harder to find. And so we need to think about other ways of thinking about them and finding them. It is not to science, therefore, but to metaphysics, imaginative literal religion, that we must turn to answers of questions having to do with first and lost things. And that's really the point I wanted to make. I want you to remember two things. One is that your genes are not blueprints, but they're much more dynamic, like transistors, so that's something I should remember. And the thing I want you to remember is that science, as powerful and as beautiful and as amazing as it is, as much as I pinch myself that I get paid money, in fact, for many of you, it's your tax money, so thank you very much, to think about this, the fact is, science cannot tell me most of the really important questions of life. Those are the questions of meaning, the questions of purpose, and questions of value, questions of morality, all those kinds of questions. It can't answer those questions by its very nature. And when I ask myself back to this question of who am I, I have to find some other, who am I, why am I here? I have to find some other source of meaning for this. And if I was giving a different talk, if the question I've been asked is, how do you find meaning in your life as a Christian, then I would tell you about how that works. But that wasn't really what I was asked to do. But I do think that I'll give you just one thing that I think is important for me. So ask myself, who am I? As a Christian, I think that I am something we read in the Bible. For we, all of us actually, are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. It's a bit of a mouthful, but basically this is saying, if I ask myself, why am I here? I think it's because I was created by God in order to do something on this earth, and God made me for this way. And this is the source of my meaning. And that's obviously not a scientific answer. That's an answer I get from thinking about scripture. It's an answer I think about thinking philosophically about the way the world is, thinking theologically about the way the world is, something I learn from people around me. It has the nature of relational knowledge or the nature of personal knowledge, but I think it's a very valuable way of looking at the world. And whether it's true or not is a different question. It has to be adjudicated on other grounds than science. Science doesn't undermine this in any possible way. I may be wrong about my religious beliefs, but to a large extent, science is not the way of figuring that out. I have to figure out other ways. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention, and I'm looking very much forward to your questions.
Oh, thank you very much indeed for a thought-provoking talk, which now takes us, as promised, to the second phase of the evening. And we're going to open up the floor to questions.
I won't make I'll give you a very generic way of thinking about this, which is that if you think about the world and you think it's likely there is a God of some kind, then the next question you might ask yourself is, does this God interact with the world today in a way that's meaningful? Right? And then if that were the case, then that would be very important if it were the case. Right? And so in that case, you might wonder, how would such a God communicate with us? And that's another interesting question. So one way that such God might communicate with us would be through some kind of written text. So we could look at a written text, which for many religions is an important thing. So we could look at a text, then we could ask ourselves, does this text have the ring of truth to it? Does it seem like the kind of thing that God might have written to us? And so that's why looking at text might be a really important thing, and taking it really seriously and studying it in some depth. And so that would be one way. So the Christians would look at the Bible, and the Muslim might look at the Quran, etc. Then when I compare different religions is a question you should ask a theologian to give you a lot of detail. There are obviously big differences between religions. Religions make different claims, different ontological claims, different moral claims, and you would need to decide for yourself which of those is actually true. But the important point is that what you really can't do is kind of sit on the sideline and say, well, I don't really, there's a bunch of them, I can't really decide between them, so I'm just going to sit back. Because it's a bit of a lazy approach. Right? You have to take them seriously, and take them seriously, and look at their best proponents, not their worst proponents, and try to understand them as well as you can. And that's thank you, that's a very excellent question. So, it's true that I do not like the first two answers to my question, why something here, because I think the consequences of this are fairly bleak. In other words, if we're nothing but atoms and molecules, so there really is nothing else besides this, then it becomes really hard to ground something like moral truth. So by moral truths, I mean something like it's compassion is good regardless of whether I believe in it or not. It's not just some kind of epiphenomenon or something that we've agreed together or something that happens to improve our survival or our fitness. So that's why I choose the third of those three options. However, the reason I brought those three options up was not to say that they're obviously better or worse on their own merits. The reason I brought them up is to point out that everybody, whether they believe in God or not, has to make some kind of metaphysical step. And so I think that, so that's one reason I don't like it. The other reason I don't like it is because I think it, if you assume that there's nothing but atoms and molecules, just science, you actually, so if you believe in scientism, which is the idea that science is the real answer to everything, scientism itself has some really deep problems. One of the really deep problems it has is that it's self-referentially incoherent. In other words, what that means is it needs to make a non-scientific claim about itself in order to say that science is the only way of achieving knowledge. And that itself is immediately a step outside of its own bounds, so it's not a closed system. You might say, well, that's just so what, right? But there are other actually deep problems which we discuss a bit in quite a bit of length in the film. And those are questions, problems like this. So most of us who engage in mathematics, for example, or physics, have a very strong sense that we don't just make it all up, but we discover aspects of it. So surely the way that we happen to formulate our mathematics might be driven by our own backgrounds, cultures. But there are you really sense very powerfully that you discover truths about mathematics. And I've never met a mathematician who doesn't say that's the sense that we have. So it's like those things were true before we discovered them. And you can think of all kinds of beautiful equations that we came up with that they're out there, they were true before we knew about them. So then you can ask yourself the question, if these scientific truths are true, so there's scientific facts that are out there, where are they, right? Are they behind the moon? Are they behind the sun? They're not anywhere. They're not physically instantiated. They're non-physical realities that are true. And for people like Alex Rosenberg or others, that's the biggest problem for scientism, is that you can't account for something like mathematics. And if mathematics was just something that we played a game with outside there, you might say, okay, whatever. But in fact, mathematics has this incredibly deep traction on the physical world. So it's not just something that we can ignore. And then it's not, so that means that in and of itself, that kind of pure naturalism has a real big problem with this kind of non-material reality. And then there comes a second step, which is that if there are non-material realities like mathematics that are true, it would not at all be surprising if there were also moral realities that are true, non-physical realities that are true, regardless of whether you believe in them or not. And that seems very plausible, actually, once you make that step, that first step. And then you might say perhaps there are spiritual realities that are also true, regardless of whether you believe them or not. And that's maybe one step too far for some people, but that's a step that I find quite natural. So David, my co-presenter, really liked this mathematics argument because he realized that from his own atheism, he was running into a lot of problems for finding meaning or finding purpose. And so the idea that there are these mathematical truths that are true, there might be moral truths that are true, is something that he found very comforting. And I can see why. I did leave that one out, yeah. So, you know, if you ever watch The Matrix, you can get slightly worried, but actually it's something that we might live in a hologram, right? There's all kinds of ideas that the world is an illusion, right? Maybe you're all brains and bats, and you just feel like... In fact, one of the weirdest things about this is that it's really, really hard to prove that this isn't the case, okay? And so you have to kind of... You take it on faith. You often... Philosophers sometimes call this that it's kind of a basic belief that you have about the world, right? Just like the idea that that other people have minds that are independent and they're not just a whole bunch of computers trying to fake you. Something you can't really prove, but you just take on faith. And if you, just because you can't prove it doesn't mean that you should therefore be skeptical about it, is the argument. And there might be many other things about the world that have that nature of being basic beliefs, and therefore beliefs that are true even though you can't necessarily prove them to be true. Well, that's a good point. So I think I skated over the much more complicated and difficult question, which is how do you adjudicate between different religious faiths? How do you get between different moral systems? And I think science plays a really important role there. So if a religious system makes a claim that is somehow scientifically clearly false, then that's a big count against that religious system. And so for Christians, for example, the central core of Christian faith is the fact that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. So if one day we were to find a tomb that is unequivocally the tomb of Jesus Christ who never rose from the dead, then that would falsify my faith. And I think it's important for faith to have to be falsifiable in that kind of sense. Otherwise, it becomes a little bit too slippery. So that would be an example of something that could be falsified, right? So the faith. So the thing about Christian faith a little bit is like this. It's a little bit like when you get to know somebody and you want to get married to them. It's not like you just, a blind faith is stepping out on the street and grabbing the first best person you see and then just believing without taking any evidence. You try to gather evidence. You ask yourself, as a Christian, for example, one thing you do is you ask yourself, is the Bible, does it seem to be a reliable document? Does it have aspects of it that are the kinds of things you might expect from a book, from a divine book? And you might ask yourselves questions like, is there some historical reliability to this? So if people claim that Jesus Christ existed, is there some good historical evidence for this? And these are really important things to take you and take you a certain step of the way. And you need to take those things seriously. You need to study them and think about them and ask yourself, does this make sense? And if there are really deep, you know, logical or scientific problems, then that counts against it. And you've got to try to work your way around it or think about it. But in the end of the day, Christian faith is not just about a kind of intellectual assent to a set of propositions. It's also about a kind of personal interaction with God. So just like in my own married life, the fact that that my wife loves me or that I love my wife is not just a set of things I can tick off, but it's also something that I take a step of faith and assume that it's true. And as I do that, I actually gain more evidence for it. So it's like a feedback process. I have to make a step of faith. In other words, Christians would say, you gather some evidence, but at some point you take a step of faith and you decide to believe in God and commit yourself to God. And only by so doing do you actually gather some of the evidence that might be there for religious belief. So religious belief is not just assent to propositions, it also has a relational aspect. And if you take a step back and think to yourself, well, if there was a God who created this world, it would be surprising if the only way you could know about this God was through kind of intellectual study and scientific study, because by doing that, God would therefore rule out large swathes of people who haven't had the luxury of learning this kind of stuff, right? So we've, in the West, particularly in the wealthier West, if we're born in the right backgrounds even here and have the right education, we have the luxury of spending time at university, for example, and thinking about these things. But many people, that's just not impossible for them. So it'd be odd if the primary way of learning about God would be through just this kind of intellectual exercise. That doesn't mean that's not very valuable, it just would be odd if it wasn't also a relational aspect to it, which is, I think, what the Christian religion, which is the one that I understand the best, teaches as being an incredibly important part of Christian faith. So Christian faith is not only understanding things and knowing things, it's also what we might call a personal relationship with God. That's a very good question. So this is a very good question, because if you assume, for example, that the meaning of a human being is somehow linked to how many people love them or what they do in their lives, then the death of a child in infancy may be of very little value. And there's a very famous philosopher, Peter Singer, who's trying to derive morals from other, what we might call utilitarian principles, so some kind of principle like, our morals come from the idea of trying to minimize harm or maximize happiness. And he's argued that in some cases, you know, a child that dies very early is worth less than somebody who lives longer, or maybe even an animal that lives longer, because obviously this child has lost his meaning. A Christian would say that the meaning of someone's life is primarily and almost exclusively caused by the fact that God loves them. So the reason why we in the West believe that humans are equal is not because we thought about it scientifically and realized that was true, is because we have in our roots this very deeply Christian idea that humans' value comes not from themselves intrinsically, but is extrinsic to them by the fact that they are loved by God. And if that's true, then if a child who is born and dies in infancy, then their value or their meaning is equal to the value of somebody who does many great things. It doesn't mean that those many great things aren't valuable things. It just means that the meaning that they doesn't come from what they do, but from in who they are. I think that's an incredibly important principle. If you let go of that principle, then you slide down a slippery slope very quickly, where the beautiful and the smart and the rich are have more value than the poor and the weak and the downtrodden and the ill. And there's something, I think, in all of us that senses that that's wrong, right? And I think we sense that because I believe there are moral truths out there that we have access to somehow, regardless of our religious background. But we almost all sense there's something wrong about that. But that's the direction we will go otherwise, would be my very broad brush claim. That's a kind of famous question, and you won't be surprised that people have thought about that for a very, very long time. So the point, I might take a step back and answer a different question and then answer this question. So sometimes people also say to me, well, why should you believe in God? You should show me evidence. If you don't give me evidence for God, then I won't believe in God. Just like I won't believe in a flying teapot somewhere around the earth that I can't really see because I can't see it. And you say that it's there, and I believe it's not there. And you say, well, I have faith that it's there. And why should I believe that? I should be skeptical. In other words, the default assumption is to be skeptical about these things. That assumes that God is another thing out there, like a teapot. And so if Andy comes to my lab to me and says, today in physics we discovered this new amazing particle, okay? It's the most amazing particle. You wouldn't believe how amazing it is. And I'm going to be skeptical. I said, show me some evidence for it, because I'm going to be skeptical until Andy shows me evidence for it, I'm not going to believe in it. And that's how science works. That's a really, really good way of getting scientific knowledge. So my default assumption is skepticism. But God is not an object out there like another particle or like something like ourselves, but bigger and smarter. God is, by definition, the reason why the universe exists. If there was no God, there would be no universe. And the reason why we think that is precisely because of the question that was just asked, which is that otherwise God becomes just another thing in a long list of things. But the point is that God is not another thing like our physical things. That's why the idea is that God is the first cause, or God is someone who cannot not exist. And so what that does is that out of those three options, one option is the universe has always existed in some kind of eternal state. The other one is that the universe came into being out of somewhere, right? So the one that has in some internal state, you have something that calls something that calls something, so you have this internal regress. And the third option is a completely different option, which is a traditional option of theism, which is that God is not just another object. So when you say who created God, you're not talking about the God of traditional theism, you're talking about some other kind of God. And you don't understand, sometimes you're talking about a different kind of God, not the God of theism, because that's in some sense a nonsensical question. Well, so I'll pick up one. So this is a good question. So I think it's a legitimate question, which is to say, is the Bible in conflict with science? So if I were the case that I believe the Bible taught that the whole universe and the earth was created in 6 24-hour days, like we know days today, then I'd have a pretty serious problem with my Christian faith. And I think a legitimate problem. I'd have to either think about why science is wrong or think about why the Bible is wrong. But I don't think that's actually the issue at all. And the way to get around it is by actually reading the Bible more literally than somebody who reads it at a surface level. So it's really important to remember that the Bible was not written in a kind of journalistic prose. It's not like a newspaper, and then this happened, then this happened, and that happened. And you see that by looking at the first passage of Genesis. So if you look at Genesis, chapter 1, which is the very famous passage where it talks about the world being created in 6 days, it says there's a first day, there's morning and evening on the first day, there was morning and evening on the second day, there's morning and evening on the third day, there's morning and evening on the fourth day, but the sun and the moon are not created until the fourth day. Okay, So you don't have to be a modern scientist to realize there's something fishy there, because you know, you have morning and evening all these other days, but the sun and the moon are not created to the fourth day. So why on earth would the writer be doing this? Well, take a step back and think about it. Obviously, he's trying to make a point, right? He's demoting the sun and the moon because you don't even need them for morning and evening. And if you look more carefully at the text, there are other hints at this. So the words that were used there for sun and moon are not the proper nouns, sun and moon, but the Hebrew words mean basically greater lamp and lesser lamp. So why on earth would the author do that? Well, lamps are well known. Lamps are physical objects like the ones you have in your tents. So what the author was saying, the sun and the moon are physical objects like the ones you have in a tent. They're a big lamp and a smaller lamp, and that's it. So first of all, he demotes them to the fourth day, and second, he says they're just physical objects. Well, put yourself into the time when the Bible was being written. What was the intelligentsia, the scientific consensus of the time? It was astrology. People were astrologers, intellectuals were astrologers, and they believed that the sun and the moon were living beings that controlled our lives. In fact, the people of Israel at the time often were tempted to worship the sun and the moon. So the author is saying, don't worship them, they're demoted to the fourth day, and they're not living objects in the sky, they are physical objects or lights. Now, we don't think that's strange, but to people at the time, it would be as strange if I came here today to the Department of Astronomy and told all my astronomy colleagues that the sun and the moon are living beings, right? They would laugh me out of the, well, they'd probably carry me out or push me out of the room quite quickly, and for good reason. And that's how crazy it would have sounded at the time. So we don't notice it, right? But very clearly the text is doing something very different. So if the text is doing this and putting the sun and the moon in a non-chronological order, it's very unlikely that it was meant to be a chronological order. And you see this already with early church fathers. So Origen in the 2nd and 3rd century said, what man of intelligence would believe that the sun and the moon were created, that the earth was created in six lateral days if the sun and the moon were not created until the fourth day? So St. Augustine, probably the greatest theologian of the first 1,000 years from the middle of that time, especially, wrote a book called On the Literal Interpretation of Genesis, where he basically says, some take this figuratively, some take it literally, and if you don't mind my, I take it in between. So clearly, there's a lot of freedom in there to how to think about it. And once you realize that that's not what the text is doing, it gives you a lot of flexibility in what actually was happening physically, because that's not what the text was primarily about. It was primarily about the relationship between humans and God. And you can contrast that very dramatically with, say, the Gospel. So very famous at the beginning of the Gospel of Luke, so one of the four writers of Jesus' life. Luke was a physician. He writes to his friend Theophilus, and he says, I wanted to give you an orderly account of these things. So what Luke was writing down was some kind of proto-history. It was much more like history, much more saying this happened and that happened and that happened. So there we have to take it in a very different way. We have to take it as this is what actually happened, and this is a kind of historical document, because the text itself is telling you that that's what it is. Whereas Genesis text is very clearly telling you from the very beginning that this is not what I am. I'm something very different. I'm telling you something in a very different order. And the problem is, in the West, we have gotten tone deaf to almost any other discourse except for this kind of journalistic prose. But when I grew up in Central Africa in a small village, especially for an older generation of people, it was not at all uncommon for somebody to tell about something that happened in a non-chronological way. And they weren't doing that because they didn't remember the order, it's because they were trying to make a much more profound point than the chronology. And so that has been the way that humans have interacted, much more sophisticated ways of interacting with story than we're used to. And that's of course the background, the history in which the Bible was written. So it's important to take those things. It's important to take the Bible literally, which means actually looking at the literary genre in which it was written. And once you do that, then these problems often kind of dissipate away. No, that's a good point. So I think that is an interesting point, which is that there are limits to our ability to predict, right? And we see that with nonlinear systems like the weather or the economy. I had a very good friend, I won't name him, but a very prominent economist in Oxford, right around the time when Brexit was happening. After the Brexit vote, I asked him, what's going to happen now? And he said to me, well, you know, I'm an economist, but economic prediction is to economics what astrology is to astronomy. And that's because, I think it's not quite that bad, but it's because, you know, these systems are nonlinear, hard to predict. So the pushback from someone who's a naturalist would say, well, okay, so the laws of nature are not predictable in the sense that if I know the initial conditions very accurately, eventually because of chaos and deterministic chaos and because other types of fluctuations, like quantum fluctuations come in, I can't predict the future. That doesn't mean that the world isn't just still only run by the scientific laws of nature and nothing else. It just means that I have an inability to predict them. But it's an interesting point. Yeah, so I think your point, if I understand that right, is to say science has an intrinsic limit because we like to predict things, and there are things that we can't predict. And science has shown us that we can't. Right? And that is troubling. Right? It also tells you there's a very famous story of Laplace. So Laplace is a very famous French mathematician, physicist, and he had Laplace's demon that would basically know all the initial conditions and all the that one time, and therefore predict everything in the future. You can basically show that Laplace's demon therefore can't exist. Yeah, so I did take a bit of a Platonist view. I think I can take a very soft Platonism on it, right? But I am actually a little bit of a Platonist in terms of mathematical truths, as are, in fact, a very large fraction, I would say, of my mathematical and physical colleagues. And that's because our experience of these truths, or that they're out there. I'm not saying, well, this is a more complicated discussion, but I'm not saying that there are kind of perfect forms out there that we see some kind of shadow of, right? But I do think the point I was trying to make is that these things are non-physical realities that are true. And even in the softer versions of these realism, you still have the same point, which is that they're non-physical realities. So they're non-empirical truths. So for example, they're non-empirical in the sense that if I say to you that a certain mathematical truth is true, I don't need to do an experiment to show that to you. I can use the laws of logic. So they're non-empirical in that sense. So I point out that this is a big problem for hardcore scientism, because you have to have some account for these non-physical realities. So you can take that on. You can take softer versions of what they actually are without losing the strength of the argument, which is to say that these are non-material realities that are not adjudicated on empirical grounds, but on other grounds. And sometimes I'm not saying anything that surprising, but I think it's important in that it gets lost in the kind of public discussion about the power of science, because people forget that scientism, the idea that there's nothing but science and the laws of nature, it has real big problems. Thank you for that question. If you Google my name, Ard Louis Miracles, you'll see an essay I wrote on the topic, because I find the question so interesting. So that will be that's my short answer. My longer answer is to say,
okay.
Yeah. My longer answer is to say, so as a Christian, what do I think I'm doing when I'm in the laboratory? Well, we read in the Bible that God sustains the world. So if God sustains the world, that doesn't mean that God somehow got the world started and the world's kind of running on its own, and every so often he goes in and fixes it. It basically means if God were self-sustaining the world, it would no longer exist. That's the kind of classical Christian idea of theism, right? So the world is dependent on God. So if God is sustaining the world at all times, then what does it mean when I'm studying the laws of nature? Well, the laws of nature, they're not laws like the laws of legal laws that are telling nature what to do. They're descriptions of how nature works. And they're describing the regular ways that God sustains the world, so the ordinary ways that God sustains the world. And that's historically how people thought about science. There's ordinary ways that God sustains the world. And most of the time, God sustains the world by the normal laws of nature. In the Bible, we see examples of points when God sustains the world in different ways, like when he turned water into wine in a wedding in Cana, or most prominently when he raised Jesus Christ from the dead. But what's interesting is to look at the way those miracles are described. So in the New Testament, for example, there are three Greek words that are used for miracle. One of them means basically a wonder, okay, which is how we tend to use the word miracle, like a wonder, amazing thing. The second word is a work of power, dunamis. So the third one is semilla, sign, which means a sign. And the second two words are always used with the wonder. So miracles are never just a wonder that God does for some to amaze people, but they're always done as a work of power, as a sign. So they're done to further God's redemptive purposes in this world. So God normally sustains the world by these regular ways, and occasionally, if he wants to, he intervenes and sustains the world in a different way, and that's what we call a miracle. Now, if I'm a scientist, I can't, by definition, study these things we call miracles, or when God sustains the world in a way that he doesn't ordinarily do, because I don't have access to the mind of God. It's not a variable I can control in my experiments. And if one of my students comes to me and says, you know, I did this experiment and a miracle happened, I'm going to be a skeptic about that. And the reason I'm a skeptic about it is because I'd be surprised why God would want to sustain the world in a less ordinary way in this particular experiment. I can't see what the point of it would be. In other words, within Christian theism, there's a very robust explanation of what science actually is. It's studying the ordinary ways that God sustains the universe. And surely, if God is the God who sustains the world, without whom the world could not exist, it's not very hard to sustain the world in a slightly different way if you so want to and so need to, right? So these things are not at all contradictory. They're just a slightly broader way of looking at the world. Well, so that's a really good question. Do we have free will? So, if you think that we are nothing but kind of machines, then it's easy not to believe in free will. So, if you're consistent and you believe in hardcore naturalism, you're more or less. It's hard, although it can be done, to revive some idea of having free will. Because if you think that we're nothing but really wet computers, then free will is some kind of something that we don't really, that we think we have, but we're somehow fooling ourselves for it. Now, it's true that the laws of nature are not necessarily predictable, so there's a stochastic element, an unpredictable element to how even perhaps our brains work. But just because there's an unpredictable element doesn't give us free will. So I think that's as far as I can go. So I think there's a problem on naturalism for free will, although there are naturalists who find ways of getting around it. I think if you're consistent, you should probably say there is no free will if you believe in scientism. If you're a Christian, on the other hand, it's really hard not to believe in free will, because we're told continuously that we do have free will and that our choices really matter, and they matter really in important ways, in eternal ways. And so, I don't, as far as I can tell, science can't adjudicate on that question of free will, but I may be wrong. It's a complicated question. Well, thank you. So my own story is that as a teenager living in probably my mid to late teens, living in Central Africa, I got interested in these kind of big questions. And so I asked and thought a lot about them, and it was really my African friends, particularly those for whom I'd seen really dramatic changes in their lives when they became Christians, that had a very big impact on me. So I would say that was probably the dominant reason why I decided to become a Christian. Now, I should say that you can make a choice to become a Christian that's one thing that may big impact on me. I also read the Bible, had a big impact on me, so that had a big impact on me. The experience of God, personal experience of God, had a big impact on me. So all those things, the testimony of my friends, the reading the Bible, and my own spiritual experience had a big impact on me. That doesn't mean that as you grow older, you don't have to remake those choices or rethink those things through, because you run into new questions and new things to think about. And so over my life, my faith has gotten stronger rather than weaker as I've interacted with things around me. So that's very briefly my story.
You've taken us on an expansive journey, which has included very big and deep questions. You've made them witty and accessible, but you've also taken us to the personal, and we've seen some of both your beliefs and faith, but also some of your science too. So we've given you a hard time and a long time standing in front of us. Would you join with me in thanking Art for coming and speaking to us?